Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to USC. I, on behalf of the USC Sol Price School of Public Policy, it's great to see each and every one of you here at our inaugural event for our Dean's Policy Breakfast Series. As I was telling people at my table, when we hold events in the school, like a lunch, if we serve lunch, we get a much bigger audience, especially of students. So we're glad to see you all here. It's terrific that you could join us here in Town and Gown. Isn't this a beautiful setting? I just love this building. It's at the heart of USC. And we're very excited to hear from our distinguished speaker this morning, California State Treasurer John Chiang. Given that the election took place just 8 days ago, this seems like a particularly appropriate time to engage in a thoughtful conversation about the economic and political challenges and opportunities facing California. Before I begin, I wanted to make one acknowledgement, and that is for Sarah and Michael Chiang, who really introduced us to the treasurer. And so would you give them a round of applause? I'd also like to thank our sponsors of today's event. Without their support, we would not be able to put on this type of high-quality program, and I want to read who they are and then ask that you recognize them together. First, Budget Watchdogs, Creative Productions, Capital Strategies Group, Grassroots Lab, Regatta Solutions, and Tesoro. So would you please thank our sponsors. And since I think some of you at least don't know who I am, I'm Jack Knott. I'm the dean of the Price School. I have been dean now for 12 years. It's hard to believe and counting, but it's been such a phenomenal experience for me. The school is just so exciting, both with the faculty and the students and the staff and all of the constituencies. And we were just talking also about how we're so connected with the practitioner and leadership community here in California and elsewhere. I wanted to mention that this is the first ever discussion of the Dean's Policy Breakfast Series hosted by the Athenian Society, the school's premier philanthropic support organization. And the impetus behind this series was to convene civic and business leaders to share their in-depth expertise on critical policy topics and highly debated issues facing our communities. Our aim was to inspire constructive dialogue and to foster a community of engaged and informed citizens. That's really what we're about. These goals are actually reflective of the work here we do at the Price School. Our mission is to improve the quality of life for people and their communities here and abroad. And as part of that mission, we are committed through service and engagement to make a difference through events like this one today. With our conversation this morning, we have the opportunity to focus on economic policy trends over the last several years, as well as discuss the direction of California's economy. The economic impact of the Golden State is really remarkable, and it contains several lessons. One is the state boasts the sixth largest economy in the world, according to recent data by the International Monetary Fund. And we can verify that since Rodney Ramcharan used to work as a senior economist for the IMF. Our state also has generated hundreds of thousands of clean energy jobs in the midst of strong economic growth. And that says something about the role of clean energy and economic growth in combination. And California lawmakers also approved legislation raising the mandatory minimum wage to $15 an hour by 2022, which says something about California's commitment to a livable wage. Yet, while we have enjoyed considerable progress, we recognize that there are still some and continuing key challenges. One of those, of course, is a dramatic economic inequality between different types of people in the state, but also different regions. I once had a visitor from Germany, and he drove up and down the coast, and then he drove into the Inland Empire and then into the valley, and he told me there are at least two or three different Californias. And there are also very complex fiscal challenges facing the state, as the treasurer knows firsthand. And so we're very interested not only in discussing the great opportunity we have, but also these challenges and how to address them. At USC Price, we are proud to house faculty experts, including our speaker, Professor Rodney Ramcharan, who analyzed the economy really from multiple dimensions, such as economic development and job creation, affordable housing, regulatory policy, immigrant entrepreneurship, which is hugely important in California in particular, tax incentive programs, and healthcare economics, just to name a few areas. Through our interdisciplinary, problem-focused research, our goal is to inform decision-makers and leaders here and in the rest of the country, as well as to inform the broader public, to help craft sound policy solutions, as well as plan and develop better communities for the future. So as I mentioned this morning, we have the special privilege of conversing directly with the top decision-maker and remarkable public servant, Treasurer John Chiang, who oversees the state's investments and finances. And I wanted to read a quote. You know, you do too, you know, in your email box, I get letter, you know, emails from people running for president and people running for other offices. And I got an email from Treasurer Chiang, Dear Jack. So here it is. I wanted to read the first paragraph. He says, "While yesterday," and this email came the day after the election, "was hard for many of us, I look around the state of California and see hope. I continue to be inspired by the ideals that Californians hold close to their hearts. The rule of law, religious freedom, equal rights, tolerance, and economic prosperity for all." So our talk will touch on economic policy after the financial crisis, the connection between monetary and fiscal policy and inequality, and the broader economic and political challenges facing the United States. And I really look forward to an outstanding discussion. So at this time, I'd like to introduce Professor Rodney Ramcharan. He's a professor at the USC Price School and research director at the USC Lusk Center for Real Estate. He's an expert in macroeconomics, finance, and applied econometrics. Dr. Ramcharan briefed the Federal Reserve Chair and the Board of Governors on the global financial crisis. Prior to coming to USC, he also served as the first director and chief of the Systematic Financial Institutions and Markets section of the Fed. In that role, he helped develop analyses to understand better the relation of our financial institutions to the real U.S. economy. And he contributed to the regulatory policy discussion at both the Federal Reserve and internationally. He also worked, as I mentioned, for the International Monetary Fund for 10 years, contributing to policy discussions on exchange rates and monetary policy in emerging markets and developing economies. Despite all that high-level professional decision-making and responsibility, Professor Ramcharan has a very impressive publication record in top academic journals, including the American Economic Review and the Journal of Finance. And in 2014, he was awarded the Wharton Prize for the best empirical finance paper at the Western Finance Association. So please join me in welcoming Professor Ramcharan.
Thank you, Jack. Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here, and we are delighted, we're honored, really, to kick off the first Dean's Policy Breakfast with John Chiang. John is the 33rd State Treasurer of California in 2014. John, prior to taking office as State Treasurer, worked as a State Controller as well, and he did that during the crisis of 2007 and 8, and so the perspectives there must be fantastic. John has a long history in state government, working as an attorney in Sacramento and at the federal level as well. And John has a law degree from Georgetown as well. So we are honored to have John here to get his insights both on California, and let me pause and say I think things have changed in the last couple of days, and my questions are going to change a little bit as a consequence. And so I'm going to not only probe John for his views on the state, but I think I'd love to get his insights as to how what has occurred in Washington is likely to affect the state as well. So let's welcome Mr. John Chiang. So John, I'm going to begin at the beginning. We have a host of people here. I'm going to give you a chance. I'd like to understand a little bit. Could you tell us a little bit about what the state treasurer does and what your typical day is like?
Well, good morning, and thank you, Professor, and thank you to Jack and the USC Saul Price of Public Policy, and to Sarah and Michael. Sarah sent me a text or an email or her call. I forgot which one, and said, hey, you have to show up at this, and said, would be happy to do so. I love coming to you. I love coming to USC. So the state treasurer, if you do it in short terms, is the state's banker. So I am responsible for the daily investments of California and local governments, most local governments, short-term cash. So on a daily basis, we're investing about $80 billion in short-term cash. Our principal statutory charges is to make sure that we don't lose capital. Mm-hmm. Secondly, liquidity, because the city of Los Angeles has daily needs and bills they have to pay. And then third, yield. I am also the agent of sale of the state's debt. So the state has over $80 billion in outstanding issuance. We have close to $40 billion, or just short of $40 billion in approved but unauthorized, issuance of the state's debt. Then I chair 15 economic development authorities. So I'll finance things from taco trucks to Tesla. We help finance buildings here on campus at USC, so the USC Hospital, the Norris Cancer Center, the Student Center comes through conduit. We have conduit authorities, financing authorities, and one of those authorities is the California Educational Financing Authority, so that we finance public university buildings. And then I sit on CalPERS and CalSTRS, this nation's two largest defined public benefit plans.
Wow. That's a tremendous amount of things. A couple of questions on that. In terms of the financing, when you have to determine what gets funded and what does not, is that a decision that you contribute to with the governor, or how does that process work in California?
So we'll have those conversations with the issuer. So it could be the state of California, it could be the University of California, mm-hmm. it could be a Children's Hospital of Los Angeles. It depends on the authority, or USC. It depends on who's actually going to issue. And then the voters also make that choice. So if they choose high-speed rail, there's timing as to when you go out with the issuance of that particular debt. So according to those, if it's an approved measure by the voters of California, or if it comes through the governor and legislature.
I see. So a couple of topical themes that have come up, I think. One that's most topical is the topic of climate change. And people have been thinking about that and trying to understand what's the potential impact, both in an economic sense and what's likely to happen from a funding point of view. So I'd like to get your thoughts as to how do you see the prospect of climate change affecting the state, and what's the potential impact on the budget and on funding needs as well?
So the impact of climate change is very pronounced on the state of California. So California was created in September of 1850. And so if you look at the history of the climate patterns for the geographic area that constitutes California, between 1850 and 1950 were some of the wettest years. Right? A huge chunk of this state is built on desert. So we built, sometimes in consideration of what the climate impacts would be, oftentimes we did not. So in some of our wettest years, we continued to build. We're going to have formidable challenges as we go forward. As when you recognize climate change, in the old days, we used to have larger snowpack. Yes. So the Sierras would, in essence, be part of our flood control. Because you would have the snowpack, and then it would slowly melt, and then we would build our reservoirs and dams based on those historical patterns. but and used to have maybe three or four heavy snowpack seasons mm-hmm. out of every decade. Today we're down to between two and three, and it comes down in precipitation instead of snow. And so it's changed the way we have to think about how we store and use water.
Well, I mean, these are big changes because this is an agricultural state in many parts. So given that fundamental shift in terms of the snowpack, what's the adjustment process like? I mean, could we continue to be the state that grows dates and fruit and vegetables? So what's your view as to, is there going to be a transition in terms of what can be done here in this state?
We need to undergo a transition. We have to think about how we become more judicious with the mm-hmm. use of water, how we become more effective. America's consumption patterns, California's consumption patterns are different than elsewhere. Water is relatively cheap here in mm-hmm. the United States, right? We'll have some jurisdictions where basically water is a penny for, thousands of gallons, where, some would argue it's cheaper than the dirt dirt's not cheap here in California.
Absolutely not, yes.
it's very pricey, right? People want to live here. And then the water usage that isn't as economically effective, mm-hmm. we have to think about how we become much smarter about bringing and generating greater value for the use of that water.
So is that, if I hear you right, is that something that will take place in terms of the taxation on water, or is this some kind of a regulatory change that would make it difficult, say, for certain groups to use as much of the water that they have used? Thinking about it.
Sorry to interject. So a lot of both. There will be regulatory changes. There's going to have to be legislative changes. Things people don't like in government, as well as the private sector. We're going to have to measure things better. Right? How much water do we have stored underground? How much surface water do we have? Do we have people stealing water from others? And we know we do. Mm-hmm. Right? How much consumption in various areas, north versus south? And so it's going to have to take legislative changes. It's going to take regulatory changes. But then you're going to have some market intervention. Right? How do we price water mm-hmm. more effectively? And there may be tax changes because some of the water hogs that were using more water because of the legal restrictions, you couldn't price them for using water when they were using water excessively. And mm-hmm. so we ought to reevaluate. When people are using tens of thousands of gallons of water at their house unnecessarily, or you would argue not as effectively, then we ought to think about pricing mechanisms.
So I want to, you've touched upon an interesting point. This is a vast state, and there are many different interest groups involved. In terms of the politics of getting action done, what's your view on that? Is that something that we can feasibly do given the very different groups involved and the different and the incentives across these groups?
So it hasn't been done, but it needs to be done, right? Mm-hmm. So it's the political will to get everybody around the table. And frankly, leadership is about getting people as a group to move forward. Now, mm-hmm. they talk about right, principles of leadership, right? You have to exact a certain amount of pain, but you have to put pain that's not too painful so that people are resistant and won't make the change, right? So it's finding that adequate balance where that point of compromise where you can mm-hmm. move forward. I know people want radical change, but oftentimes that going too far to the right or too far to the left just freezes you at a certain point. And water is one of those areas where we can't be frozen because we don't have sufficient storage. We don't have sufficient clairvoyance as to what the weather patterns are going to be so that we have sufficient water sustainability. And then we're fallowing between 500,000 and 1 million acres, which has huge impacts on economic growth in the agricultural sector.
Right. So I guess if I could follow up on that and ask it this way, then I gather from your answer that you're optimistic that there can be a political compromise that would allow some fundamental change. What's your view thus far then on the pace of change? Given that the drought has been in place now for a number of years, there's the expectation, as you pointed out, that the Southwest and the West typically goes through these phases of long droughts that last many years. In terms of the pace of change, you're comfortable with the pace at which it's gone in terms of trying to conserve?
So we don't have great holistic change, but we see changes in certain slices. So obviously water conservation measures.
Sure.
My concern and disappointment is that we had a little bit of rainfall this year. And so, you know, some areas in parts of the state that got to 100% no longer want to conserve, right? It's that short-term thinking that really hurts us, right? It's that short-term thinking in regards to the finance that got this country into trouble a few years ago. So it's, we have to think, well, if you understand that we're only get the snowfall two or three times every 10 years, we ought to save for the other seven to eight years. So not enough, but at least we're starting to change the mindset somewhat.
I see. As you were talking, you know, I've read a great deal about this. I don't want to put you on the spot per se, but in your experience, can you think of an experience where we faced a slow-moving crisis and we've been able to act in advance in a way that's rational and sensible? Is there some model or template that you have in your mind that guides you in terms of thinking about the right way to do this, in terms of past experiences and so forth?
Yeah, so in my tenure, this is my 18th year in public office. So we saw what unfolded when I became the controller, which is the state's chief fiscal officer. So I was among those responsibilities. I sat on 80-something boards, and it's not as big as it sounds. Half of them are like bond authorities that only meet once a year, and they're pro forma. I started to disclose the state's financial position.
Yes.
So in my third month in office, I started saying, what were the cash that the state of California collected? What are our disbursements? And then what's our cash position?
Mm-hmm.
And so even though it was 2007, the real estate market was still decent before it started to tank, before we had the global financial crisis the next year, and the National Bureau of Economic Research didn't call the recession until the winter of 2007.
Yes.
California on July 13th, 2007 went into a negative cash position, right? So University of Southern California, you as individuals, Michael and his businesses, right? You wouldn't want to be in a negative cash position when things appear to be bright, right? That means you fiscally mismanaged. And so California went fiscally mismanaged. And I was trying to signal to the governor and legislature, hey, we got problems. We got negative cash position. And then unfortunately things got worse the next year. Now, we had a financial crisis in 2009, 2008, 2009, 2010 in regards to cash. 2012, I sent a letter to Governor Brown. I said, we have cash problems again, right? And I said, I hope we've learned the lesson from 2008, 2009, 2010. Governor Brown got it. He's right. The response back from their office was, tell us what to do so we can avert another cash crisis. So. Yes, in a recent instance, we learned.
I see. Oh, that's wonderful. I mean, I often think of the world in terms of the rubric that a democracy tends to take a long time to get things done, especially big threats that take a long time. And so it's wonderful to hear that there are cases where we've been able to act quite sensibly. So my last, as I probe on the environment, a question that comes to mind is, do you anticipate that meeting the environmental challenges will lead to more spending? Will there be a need to issue more public debt to sort of finance some of the needs that might come from that space?
Ah, very good. So actually, and we didn't discuss these questions. He sent it. So actually, I've been trying to work on green bonds.
Okay.
So the state of Massachusetts was the first state out with green bonds, but they had they were well intended, but they issued some green bonds for parking lots, which had the environmental community up in arms. They're saying, parking lots, green bonds, right? That's not a
I'm going to stop you and ask you to explain what green bonds might be.
Oh, sure. So instead of what's brown bonds, the traditional bonds where you would finance infrastructure, green bonds are used to be for clean and green purposes. So renewable energy or clean water systems. And so it is a market that is developed in Europe and it's starting to develop in Asia. It's starting to develop in in Latin America. We've done a little bit of it in the corporate sector, and Massachusetts was first out in the United States in regards to municipal governments. And then California also issued $300 million in 2014, and Bill Lockyer's last year as a state treasurer. But there's no conformity, there's no clear standards, and so people are very concerned about, is it really green, or are you just producing more brown stuff? Mm-hmm. And so I've been doing a national tour, and I'm convening an international conference to get clear standards on what constitutes green bonds. If you look at the younger generation, the millennials, those students who are at USC today versus those who are in Jack and I's generation, sorry, Jack, right, the baby boom generation, the younger generation is twice as likely to support environmental measures than the baby boom generation. And so when you think about $30 to $40 trillion of wealth transfer occurring in the next 3 decades and them becoming higher in regards to their economic wherewithal, mm-hmm. right, to have that product available, we'll see if we get a pricing advantage, but at least we can add more people to the investor pool mm-hmm. so that hopefully in the long term it provides better financial advantages for California and promoting the services and products that we want as we form this state, right? Part of our future has to be the economic and environmental sustainability health of this of California.
So I guess with the green bonds, if I understand it, then by having an inbuilt audience in terms of the younger folks, you could perhaps get an advantage on funding, and you could perhaps also get more liquid bonds as well if people trade these things a bit more.
Perfect.
I see. And do
that's,
you have?
That's why you're a professor.
That's why I'm a professor. And I gather with the green bonds that they are attached to specific projects themselves. So if you're funding something for a dam or something like that, you will finance it out of a green bond.
We'll see in the future, right? There could be some targets, or there could be certain criteria that you have to meet. Mm-hmm. So,
but if I hear you on the environment, the expectation is that meeting the challenges on the environment, you may need to sort of issue more debt at some point. And it's not something that can be financed necessarily out of the current expenditures or the current funding that the state gets.
So the question is up in the air. Okay. So we know that a few years ago they put in place cap and trade.
Yes.
So there's a couple of legal questions in regards to cap and trade. So is the cap and trade in effect a tax or a fee, mm-hmm. Right? Taxes are used for general purposes. Fees are designated for certain select uses. And so there's the question is that a tax or a fee, and was it that measure put into law correctly? And then second, there's a second question, if it is in fact a legal revenue collection source, are they using those monies properly? So if part in place, the governor put together a strategic growth council, which has a few of his cabinet secretaries looking at essential funding challenges for California, such as affordable housing. Mm-hmm. But they said, we want to do affordable housing that's clean. Mm-hmm. Is that a proper use of that cap and trade money? Mm-hmm. So two legal questions that have to be determined. If not, right, it throws the funding source back up in the air for California to decide. Mm-hmm. And then we will get probe deeper into the question that you just raised.
I see. Well, you've said something on housing, and that's become very topical as well. You talked about dirt being very expensive here, and a question I have then, that at least on the front of my mind, is what role does the state play in this in terms of making housing more accessible to people? I'd like to get your thoughts on that.
So I sit on four of the, no, I said, I'm sorry, there are four housing authorities for the state of California. I sit on three of the four, mm-hmm. and I chair two. So I chair the Tax Credit Allocation Committee, which it provides the more valuable tax credit. It's the 9% tax credit, but is of limited supply. Then I also sit on the authority and chair the authority for the 4% tax credit. Which is valuable, but not as valuable as the 9% tax credit. So one of the things that I took on in my inaugural speech as a state treasurer, I said, you know, I went through my top priorities, and I said number one is housing. Mm-hmm. If you look at California, and you're more of an expert than I am in these areas, right, our poverty levels relative to others, they're in the same range based on income. But when you add the housing factor in to determining whether somebody is in poverty status, it truly elevates yes. to a material degree how many Californians are struggling to make their lives work. And so I did the first rewrite or substantive and substantial rewrite of the affordable housing regulations, right, which was a tough process, right? You had some people were really happy, some people were really unhappy. We're talking about how to try to lead people to try to encourage more affordable housing. Mm-hmm. So some of the stuff was I did was I said, hey, I will lift what was sort of an artificial cap on how much you can make, but I wanted the developers to try to engage in deeper affordability, right? Because they would try to build to about 60% of affordable median income. Well, if you're homeless, right, and you look at the numbers of people who are homeless, right, you look at Los Angeles and they've had double-digit increases, indeed. Right, for the past few years, right, you see growing numbers, and this is punishing for me, single moms and mm-hmm. kids, right? One of every five homeless Californians is a child, right? You're thinking, oh, right, they're destined to a life that's not going to be very promising, and that's not the ideal of what is California. So I tried to rewrite the rules to say, hey, we want you to take on greater obligations, mm-hmm. And we'll let you make more money doing it. So so we went through that process last year. So I think we built 13,000 units in Bill Lockyer's last year as the chair of that authority, and today from January to August of the year, so this year, we've increased it 24,000. So the very deep affordability, right. we need about 60,000. So by the time I conclude as treasurer, we won't get up there, but at least I have the curve hitting the right trajectory to make sure that we take full advantage of what resources are available. But when you think about affordable housing, mm-hmm. it is a mix of contributors. So there's a federal contribution mm-hmm. Portion, and I'm very concerned. We will see where the Senate leadership and President-elect Trump choose to go in regards to providing a roof over the head for the most vulnerable Americans. There's a state component. We haven't gone out for a housing bond in a long period of time, but at least we're pushing what we have out, as I tried to do. And then when local governments lost redevelopment agencies during the financial crisis, as a component of the redevelopment agency financing, there was a 20% set aside. And so while you saw Los Angeles and others, that's a huge chunk of money. Mm-hmm. And so, mm-hmm. right, as cities tried to recover and make their balance sheets whole, yeah. They didn't have these monies. And that's why you saw what was happening here. Combination of people right at the margin losing their jobs, and then the cities throughout the state, San Francisco, Los Angeles, Fresno, San Diego, losing their 20% set aside, being unable to make those contributions. And that's why you see this skyrocketing homelessness. The voters made a powerful decision to try to provide local governments here, Los Angeles and elsewhere, at least some start, which leads to other things. I don't know how many young people are here. Michael was talking about how he's going to encourage his son, Andrew, who is really a terrific talent, to be a real estate lawyer. Right, we pushed out money for affordable housing, and then we're talking about trying to tackle the homeless. Right, there are not enough homeless, affordable housing developers with expertise with all that money to build in the state of California. So part of that is what you guys do here at USC. It's that human capital, that talent, and building that expertise. Right, we can put the money into that space, but if you don't have people who know how to do it and make those projects pencil out, mm-hmm. then we still have a housing challenge.
Mm-hmm. So you've said something that has struck me. So if I heard you correctly, one in five children are homeless in this state.
That's no, one of every five who are homeless are children.
Are children? I see. And you've traced
the numbers I was given. Yeah.
Okay, you've traced that out to coming from the crisis. So these numbers increased after the crisis, after the local governments lost their capacity to fund these homes.
So I'm not sure about causation, right?
Okay.
You know, that's your guys' expertise, whether it's causation or correlation.
Mm. Yeah. But in general, then the perspective from at least from the state level is that you're gonna sort of incentivize housing via tax expenditures, as opposed to direct capital spending.
So they are trying to. So that was part of the discussion. So Governor Brown pivoted from his historical record. The mm-hmm. governor has not when in his tenure as mayor of Oakland, and he was concerned about government resources in regards to housing construction, even though a lot was happening in Oakland. So for his first few years, he did not set aside additional money for affordable housing, and even on things that were free. So for instance, Senator Jim Bell, who I give credit, I was trying to figure out how do we maximize tax credits, and he introduced legislation that wouldn't have cost any money out of the general fund revenue pot. Governor Brown vetoed it, right? And so part of the speculation was the governor was just unhappy with other measures, so he just vetoed those pot of bills that was coming out of the legislature. But this past legislative session, he put $400 million into the pot, but he also wanted certain reforms, right? He said he wanted these projects expedited through the process, which is a good thing, right? But there were some things that people in the labor community, those in the environmental community, things in regards to CEQA neighborhood, input into building these projects would be expedited. And so it met fierce political resistance. So it didn't have enough time to work itself through with the remaining time in the legislative session to see if they could come to some type of resolution.
I see, but I gather that you think it's possible going forward that there will be some kind of a consensus that will get these things done.
We will get something. We need more, and we need it on a consistent basis.
Could you then give me a flavor of the politics? I mean, what are sort of the debate around these issues to help us as an audience make sense of this?
CEQA is a challenge. And obviously, that's been a huge change for a long period of time. How much input? Well, so right. So within the CEQA, you got the environmental issues, right? The and then that offering by the governor, right, took away some of local autonomy. Right? And cities, neighborhood residents were saying, "Hey, just because you pass these measures, we want to decide if you're going to build this senior complex near Los Angeles City Hall or something like that, or Cerrito City Hall." So how much balance between decisions being exercised by those in Sacramento versus those being exercised by local governments?
Yeah. So I came from the East Coast, and what has struck me in California is the degree of decentralization here. And you have this wonderful website where you put up all the issuance of debt by local governments and towns. I found that incredible. I think, is it $30 billion or $1 trillion of issuance? Tell me a little bit, do local governments get themselves in trouble? And you know, how big is that problem here?
So you're a nerd, and I say that with, and I say that with remarkable fondness. Because we've worked really hard to get that out, right? So it's, and it's award-winning. So what you're referencing is Debt Watch.
Debt Watch.
So yes. I put up the history of $1.5
trillion
worth of borrowing by all levels of government in the last 30 years in the state of California. Because one of the things, lessons learned during the recession was San Jose was one of the first redevelopment agencies that were evaluated, and the credit ratings agencies downgraded them. But then they proceeded to downgrade most of the redevelopment agencies in the state of California. And he said, that's not right, right? Because they said, they're not all of the same credit quality, right? Some are in better financial position than others. And right, meaning at the end of the day, that's more taxpayer dollars that Californians are gonna have to shell out because of lower credit quality. Lesser credit quality. So early on back then, I put up four award-winning websites on financial transparency. So I put up by the numbers, which put out specific cities, jurisdictions, what their finances are, because some were doing well, some were doing poorly. But I didn't want taxpayers to have shell out more money because the credit ratings agencies just said, "Hey, we don't think they're doing well." And so I said the same thing with Debt Watch, because people need to know how much is being borrowed, is being used properly, is it being paid back timely, because it has an implications for our sustainable financing of local jurisdictions in California. You can hopefully identify bad practices. This Poway School District borrowed, I think, 121, and it's in that range. I don't remember the precise numbers. And they did what's a capital appreciation bond. For those of you who aren't in municipal finance, or Mike Roos knows this stuff, right? Capital appreciation bonds, right? It's sort of like a balloon payment, mm-hmm. right? So 40 years later, they were going to have to pay close to $1 billion in a balloon payment, right? Yeah. Who wants to move into that community with a great school district but not know that's going to happen?
Yeah.
Can you think about that later on, what it's going to do to the property values,
yeah.
what it's going to do to the finances of that school district and people moved into that community without having a understanding of that financial term or that practice and what it does to them, right? It was a ticking time bomb.
Mm-hmm.
Now, fortunately, they took action and they did that, but that's why I wanted to disclose those practices.
Yeah.
So people in local communities that we can encourage civic democracy so that you can have better governance. Yeah. And part of that came out of, some of you may know, I audited the city of Bell and took on the corruption in the city of Bell and just wanted to highlight its financial practices. Right, it's terrible. You have a low-income community, and you're just saddling them with bad debt, illegal taxes, as mm-hmm. later identified, because you had four or five city administrators who didn't do the right thing.
Mm-hmm.
Whether you attribute to incompetence or bad motives, I won't do either, but something like that happened.
Yeah.
So they borrowed, they borrowed tens of millions of dollars, but in their last tranche, they had like 20-something million dollars. Where they're paying interest and it's sitting idly in a non-interest-bearing account, right? What a waste, right? That's why I wanted to highlight all those practices. Because if you're sitting $20 million, right, people of decent financial intelligence saying, God, you gotta do something better.
Yeah. So, I mean, you've mentioned you used the word nerd and I guess you've
inspired
me. I
get called nerd too.
I love it.
So we're trying to do that nerd's rule, right?
That's right.
I had a failed high school football career.
I didn't even try. So have you studied or looked at the propensity to use certain kinds of funding by local governments as a function of their structures in terms of, and feel free to punt on this as well, in terms of the way the local government is structured or the income levels inside the local government as well. Is this something you've looked at or thought about a bit?
So, yes, we've looked at it. I looked at it more during the financial crisis because mm-hmm. during the recession, we had four California cities file for bankruptcy.
Yes.
And so that's frankly one of the reasons we put up By the Numbers website so that others could look at it and who had a better sense of what's happening in those communities. So for instance, one of those cities that filed for bankruptcy was Vallejo. And Vallejo, you could see coming down the pike, right? Because if you're a base city, mm-hmm. military base city, right? And they go through this whole base closure process and your funding goes from $70 million from the federal government 1 year to $50 million 1 year to $30 million.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, you guys have a $40 million gap mm-hmm. that you're going to have to fix, right? Either through reduction of costs or raising additional revenues, right? You got to make the choice, but when you choose not to, you end up in the position that they did where they had to file for bankruptcy. So,
mm-hmm.
yes, and then I try to promote greater financial education for the general public, but I understand the general public's not going to focus there, right? We've got real lives to work on. But especially those who work in municipal finance, right? So when you're looking at this, you have to look at service level solvency, mm-hmm. cash solvency, budget solvency, long-term solvency,
mm-hmm.
right? The metrics that you look at municipal finance. And it's not easily understood or tracked, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm the only person in California history that has served in all three finance offices, the Board of Equalization, the
yes.
State Controller, the State Treasurer, right? So my job is, with my background, how do I fund and finance the operations of not only California, but I mentioned USC or,
mm-hmm.
some help them with their taco trucks or small business trying to rehabilitate their building so they're not sued by somebody for ADA non-compliance.
Sure.
So that's how I look at it. But, my colleagues in state government are terrific, right? They have other mm-hmm. experts. but it's we need to build greater depth because, you know, this conversation that I have, I can't have with anybody else in state government because they haven't served in all three positions I have.
I see. So has Debt Watch then made a difference in terms of, has it lead to a greater spread in funding costs as banks are better able to judge who's a better credit risk and who's not? Has funding costs come down as well on account of this?
It will. It may have. I'm not sure because I haven't tracked every city. But if you look at the municipal analysts on Wall Street, they really like it.
Okay.
Right. They say it provides a greater transparency, a greater understanding. Mm-hmm. As we provide more information, it gives cities and jurisdictions what goes up and down. Right. If you're in worse condition, if you don't want to do it, but at least it gives more accurate information, mm-hmm. and certainly to the investors. One of the huge roles I have is to make sure that the 40 major investors in California are secure with where we are. Right. That's why I took the action in 2009. Right. As the state controller, sometimes you have to make people unhappy. Mm-hmm. Many of you probably were unhappy. I got a lot of nasty emails. I held back your tax refunds for 23 days in February of 2009. And then in July, from July 2nd to September 4th of 2009, I issued 450,000 IOUs to the tune of $2.6 mm-hmm. billion. But I did that to prevent the financial collapse of California's government. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You could compare us today to Puerto Rico, right? Yes. Puerto Rico's debt last year was trading at 13%. California's debt is trading at 3%+. Would you rather have a mortgage of 13% or would you rather have a mortgage of 3%? Right? As your state treasurer, we've worked aggressively with our better credit ratings, not mm-hmm. great, but better credit ratings, to reduce the cost that all of us as taxpayers are paying. So over the last year and three quarters as your state treasurer, I've saved us $4.5 billion through refinancing of debt. Mm-hmm. So we're trying to, right? People don't pay attention to that because it's not sexy. It's like you get a better FICO score. You pay less on your credit card, right? But you actually pay it on time, right? Instead of paying 6% mortgage, right? You pay a 4% mortgage, right? I mean, it's stuff you and I talk about, right? But you talk to other people, it's like, we don't want to talk about that. but it's like, you know, when the governor says, John, find me some money, or, you know, they come in, it's like, hey, we want to finance electrical charging stations mm-hmm. on the roadways. We're going to find money to build this water storage. Mm-hmm. It's like, hey, we're working. You know, we're coming up with different ideas, and actually, you know, we're saving money. So,
well, John, if there are any PhD students in the audience, I want you should go to Debt Watch and download the data.
You're becoming my hero.
and you would have access to some amazing data that will help you understand how differences in local government structures affect the funding costs. And see, you could then study when John puts the data up, what happens to the dispersion and spreads as well. So I think it's a fantastic thing that he's done, and I encourage you to take a look as well.
Can I talk a little bit about the impact? So during the recession, when I was trying to keep California's credit rating from going into junk bond status, and to understand this, if California's debt goes into junk bond status, 80% of the investors have to sell. Right, because they have to be investment grade debt. Right, and can you see, right? You get it, right? Imagine the value of your assets just.
That's a fire sale.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. And so I was trying to keep it from going into junk bond status. California, relative to AAA rated states, we are paying $209 million more than versus AAA rated states for every $1 billion borrowed for a 20-year maturity. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So let's say that state of Virginia was paying, right, $200 million, then we're paying $400 million on it, right, plus the return of principal. That adds up to a ton. Yeah. Today, that spread from $209 million during the recession is now $19 million, right? We just saved you $190 million.
Well, I think that's a fascinating point, and it's something I don't know. So this is the state of Google and Facebook and Apple. As Jack said, it's the sixth largest economy in the world, right? Why did we get so close to junk bond status, and why are bond ratings not AAA?
So the three of the eight or nine major ratings agencies evaluate based on different principles. So mm-hmm. some evaluate on economic growth, mm-hmm. some on fiscal management, some on structural, right? There's a balance of all of them, but some will put greater emphasis in certain categories. So what they don't like is basically what the voters choose, right? Mm-hmm. So that's why we have it in place, right? So the ratings agencies don't like Proposition 13.
Right.
We did it to put a cap on how much mm-hmm. we would have in growth on assessed value, or actually payment, right? The assessed value can grow, but you're not paying it on the full assessed value. So they don't like that. Mm-hmm. They don't like Proposition 98, where we guaranteed that 40% of the general fund revenues would go to education. Mm-hmm. Because what they want to see is during a financial crisis that we have enough flexibility nice. To react to crisis. And so they said California has handcuffed policymakers and financial leaders' ability to make decisions. Mm-hmm. And so that's why on a credit analysis basis, we have lower standing than others. So I forgot which of the three major ratings agencies put out a report 4 or 5 months ago. Right? They said of the 20 major states in the United States of America, California is number 19 out of 20 in its ability to respond to a recession just because of all the restrictions that we have.
I see. So therefore, if I understand you, we don't have the flexibility when things get bad.
Right.
And so therefore, we get a lot of the volatility in spending things. So the state is forced to cut back tremendously when things are bad, and then can spend more when things are good, and it doesn't have the capacity to reallocate its revenue when things change.
So let me give you an example from the financial crisis. So during the financial crisis, under California laws, and the voters chose it, our number one priority or payment priority is education. Mm-hmm. Number two is debt service. However, right, when I was trying to manage during the financial crisis, I'm trying to pay our debt because I don't want to trigger a default. Right. A state under the 1937 bankruptcy provisions cannot file for bankruptcy. But so I wasn't trying to keep us out of bankruptcy because we couldn't go into bankruptcy.
Yes.
But what I was trying to do is I was trying to prevent us from defaulting so that we would be in a functional bankruptcy, right? Yes. Because I can't pay bills, right? People start suing me, right? And even when I was trying to manage, I'll give you an example. So we had work with the counties association, and I told the counties that I was going to pay them close to 1 month late. Because we had cash flow problems, right? But so I was trying to signal to everybody that the state paid, I will pay you, tell us who's gonna be really impacted, who needs a hardship exemption, right? Yeah. Who really needs, right? I felt like, is it George or Harry? George during It's a Wonderful Life, remember when there was the run on that bank, right? And it's like, and the nice old lady goes, you know, she's asking for the money. Said, do you really need the $2 or the $4 or whatever it is, right? That was sort of my office, right? We will give you money if you're really, really in trouble, but can you not ask for more money because we need money to pay for other bills, right? So we were like, It's a Wonderful Life. Right, I was trying to pay that, make sure we didn't default on the debt service. Mm-hmm. But education, which is anywhere from 51 to 53% of the state budget, we had to make sure legally that we paid correctly. So what I was trying to signal to the market, and a lot of people made money on what I said,
yes.
I said, over my dead body, are we gonna default on debt, right? Yes. Because I didn't want the collapse and everybody hauled into court, because even though I'm a lawyer and I like lawyers, what a waste if we put tens of millions of dollars into lawsuits against each other when we should be trying to resolve these issues ourselves. So when I brought up the county, it's like, hey, we had agreed to one month, they would get their payment a little bit late. And they said, we got this taken care of. We worked with our counties. Mm. What happened? 38 counties sued me. I said, hey, what happened? You know, we worked this out.
I've had those meetings.
I'm in government. We do that all the time.
So as you said that, now, you know, I was in D.C. in 08 and 09, and, you know, in the middle of the tumult, you don't know how it's going to turn out. It's turned out okay. You're sitting here, you're making very important choices in 08 and 09. Could you tell me, from a personal point of view, what's going on in your mind? I mean, what's your emotional state? Because you're looking at the bond spreads going up. You're hearing news about TARP, you're hearing news about the Congress not able to act in D.C. And you don't know in the middle of this show how it's going to end, right? So what's your day like? You come into the office, you put on Bloomberg, do you panic? Do you sweat? I mean, what's going through your mind?
Just it's a lot of hard work and it's a grind, right? Yeah. I mean, you don't control others. You can try to influence, but you just have to make sure that you put your best practices in place, right? So, you know, I work on a lot of funding and financing throughout the state, right? So the, you know, trying to, as you mentioned, right, the long end of the curve now is very concerned about.
We'll talk about that. Yeah.
President-elect Trump, yeah. Right? But if he puts, you know, any certainty into the market, and I don't know if he wants to put certainty into the market, right? I think part of his cachet and part of Governor Brown, they like being unpredictable, mm-hmm. right? They use that to their political advantage.
The bond markets don't like that.
Yeah, yeah. They like certainty, right? Yeah. That's why I'm in my position, right? I don't get to be wild,
yes.
Right? Because they want it, right? When you're dealing with people in finance, if I was your renter, you want to make sure you're going to get paid, right? Mm-hmm. My job is to say California's normal. Mm-hmm. We're going to do all the normal things, right? We're not the wild child. At least in regards to money, so that they can trust us, right? That's why we got the drop in spreads dramatically during those past few times. So no, it's just making sure that we do what we're supposed to do. And I was more hopeful, right? And I don't want to get too partisan. I was more hopeful that the federal government would be more supportive of California.
Mm-hmm. In 08 and 09, you mean? Or?
No, just who are leadership in Washington, mm-hmm. D.C. Mm-hmm. Right, because, you know, people have different political philosophies,
yes.
Right? And people come from political bents, and people understand who's supportive mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. politically and who's not. And this is a state that went Democratic, and you have a Congress and you have a White House that's Republican.
Yes.
So, you know, it's like, why are you going to go out on a limb and help California? Hopefully you're altruistic and going, hey, you know, we're 12 to 13% of the economy,
yes.
Right? We're on the Pacific Rim. You know, if you want to, President-elect talked about tariffs, right? If you want to try to create more global economy, if you want to try to create jobs, bring in foreign direct investment, you want to try to create greater prosperity. Hopefully you will be supportive, but
yeah.
You know, I don't know which way they're going to go on that decision. But in the past, it hasn't worked really well.
So I'm very tempted to go there, but I do want to just stop just a second and give you, at least I'm curious to ask you, as we transition to something I think bigger now, tell me a little bit about what inspired you to get into public service. So you're growing up in the United States. What leads you to decide? I'm sure you're a smart person. You can do many different things. What leads you to this role?
So I'm the oldest child of immigrant parents who came to this country, and so we were discriminated against. And it was painful as a child of 6 and 7 to be excluded from the process, right? I grew up in south suburbs of Chicago. Our great insurance commissioner, Dave Jones, was a high school classmate of mine. He was student body president. I was student body vice president. We ran as a ticket. And what's really reassuring to me, Dave, is like, oh my God, he goes, I know how much discrimination. He just watched it. So it's nice to have somebody supportive who knows your life history. But I grew up in an era, right, the 1960s. So I wanted to be one of those rabble rousers at Cal, right? I just wanted to say equal rights, everybody's important, right?
Yeah.
Let's love each other, right? And as some people go, you're a bleeding heart liberal. I go, what's bad about liking each other, right? What's bad about valuing each other, right? Isn't it more constructive when we try to support each other and what USC is doing here? Like, don't we like community? Right? Don't we like the United States after September 11th, where we're all Americans? So, you know, so I'm trying to get us to a better place. So I didn't have this design necessarily of public service. I wanted to be a civil rights attorney, but then I went to law school in Washington, D.C.
Yes.
And so here I am, dead broke, cheap penny loafers, khaki pants that are frayed at the bottom, right, just going through law school, and then got opportunity to work on Capitol Hill, and I was just so inspired, right? It's like, wow, it's like I'm broke, but I get to try to make laws that try to help people. And so the, that's also one regret. I wish I made more money, but the, I love the opportunities that are given, and I like helping people, right? So. When I came out here and worked at the Internal Revenue Service, it was intellectually very interesting, but I was just barren inside. Right? It's like, I'm not helping people. Right? I don't feel it. And so every day, and right, I get to meet all of you, and together I have this hope that we can really make this place one that's aspirational. Right? You just, right, I liked USC. USC 1960s reached out to the Asian countries. Right? I mean, they were visionary. Right? The right. We wouldn't have the Michael and the Sarahs and the others, right? You know, your partnership with, how do you pronounce it? Fauché, the Learning Center, right? It's like you're bringing Latinos and African Americans from lower income communities, but you're building your communities. So it's like, right, that's the America I want. I mean, I love America regardless, but, you know, it's easier to love when people are supportive of each other.
Yeah. I'm going to segue to the Q&A, but I'm going to take advantage of my role here and ask you the first one.
Such a professor.
How did you feel last Wednesday morning?
I was sad, but I was like, you know, you just go back to work, right? For me, it's I just reference my history. It's like, ah. You know, it's like, for me, this is like going back to the 1970s. It's like, you know, you fought for America that really believed in each other, right? Mm-hmm. You know, it's like, right, I'm of that generation, Martin Luther King, right? It's not the color of your skin, it's the content of your character, right? You know, who wins out of you?
Patrick Martinez, USC grad, got my undergraduate at Sol Price, got my master's at Sol Price. Known you for a very long time, John. So basically, my mom's an
Are you an alumni contributor?
I graduated last year. I'm working on it. But basically, my mom's in education. She's a superintendent, right? And so, right, they've already done their budgets for next year and the year after. So we've talked about the past. So what about the future in terms of our economic stability here in California? How do you see it in the next 2, 3, 4 years?
Well, the professor knows better than us, right? We're a little long on the tooth in regards to times between recessions, but there's no extraordinary bubble out there, right? You have subprime automobile loans that are a little excessive, but in regards to recessions, you never anticipate what type of shock moves the market. So a lot of the brainiacs, right, expect continued growth, but not all that great. State revenues are starting to plateau a little bit. Governor Brown, who's, for those who don't always like the way he budgets, is notorious for budgeting conservatively. From my perspective, that's a good thing. But even with his very conservative budgeting, for a few months, we actually came up on the short side. So it's a little bit concerned, but just as though the volatility of the state tax revenues, when I challenged Governor Schwarzenegger in the legislature in 2008, he signed a budget in excess of $103 billion. And I said, Governor, how do you think we're gonna have revenue collections of $103 billion? So that date was September 23rd, 2008. Hmm. Think of that date, yeah, you're right? You said, right? That was the week after the largest bankruptcy in United States history, Lehman Brothers. Bank of America acquires Merrill Lynch, AIG becomes public, and because of those issues, right, the stock market is tanking. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so we collected about $88 billion, right? But that's part of the reason I was unpopular in Sacramento, because I was always challenging people's numbers, right? But, you know, school districts, so the voters passed Proposition 30 in November 2012, right? The governor, in part, made the case that we needed to shore up education funding. To give you a sense of where we were, in California back then there were about 6.25 million K through 14 students. and 188 school districts educating 3 million of the California 6.25 million students were in a school district that was either in negative certification or qualified certification, meaning they had cash flow problems in the next 12 months or they had cash flow problems in the next 36 months. Today, because of the passage of Proposition 30, which increased revenues in a given year anywhere from $5 billion to $9 billion, we've reduced the number of schools that are in those financial positions down to 20. And then we know because of the measure that just recently passed, Prop 55, right, it's a continuation for another 12 years. The allocation's not the same, right? With taxes different, they didn't impose the sales tax this go around, and they split the funding not equally between education and healthcare, because healthcare is the largest, second largest expenditure in the state. So they push more money into the pot for the top two expenditures for the state. So you'll have a little bit of it being better, right? But if the economy tanks, it's still going to drop dramatically. So it's the question is how long will it happen? Because we're trying to build up our rainy day fund. So when you have like, you know, $3+ billion, and at the end of the year, you're supposed to have $8 billion. But as I mentioned, you better have good budgeting because we missed in that 1 year, $15 billion plus, and then we missed for 5 years. That's why, you know, they don't like it. But I said, like, for 5 years, it's like you guys, you know, you got the budget wrong. So, mm-hmm. Cynthia, tell everybody who you are.
Hi, John. I'm Cynthia Amador. I'm a graduate student of SC. And as John knows, my life is over right now. I'm in graduate school here. I have a question, and I'm an alumni donator. I have a question about the current rhetoric going on and uneasiness with foreign investments. And have you gotten calls it's going to affect our EB-5 funding that's coming in, the foreign investment money? Because I know across this country, mayors have gone on trips all over Asia to seek investments. And I know that, you know, many towns have profited from that and benefited from that. So are you fielding calls with people concerned about EB-5 money lessening?
So yes, but the answer is I don't know, right? I don't know if they're going to continue that program. So, and I do a lot of that work, right? I try to bring a lot. So I led a delegation to China, was it August? I don't remember when. But I brought the one on that delegation was a council member from Ontario, Alan Wapner, who worked really hard. He happens also to be the president of the Airport Commission, right? And so they were trying to get, and we had meetings in different jurisdictions with people who would invest in building like the third terminal at Ontario Airport to build an international terminal, right? So that we created greater opportunities. What I'm also very concerned about is that, you know, international transactions are looking, people are becoming very paranoid. It's like we want, you know, hey, we're on Figueroa, right? Figueroa is billionaire international investors road, right? You look at the hotels, you look at, you know, the condos that they're building, you look at the buildings they're putting up. So, right, those are jobs. Right, so yes, we want to protect American jobs. We got to do all this stuff, but we have to have this balance. But I think you're going to see a lot of elected officials get very concerned about reaching out. They won't be as concerned about reaching out to the United Kingdom, which is also a substantial investor. But money's from Latin America, money's from Asia, because you're creating this sense of, I don't want to be over dramatic, right? So paranoia is too strong, hysteria is too strong a word, but concern.
The uncertainty. Yeah.
About our relationships and people that you don't have a prevalence here, right? You know, when people always talk about, it's like, oh, the Chinese. It's like, hey, the Chinese were here in 1882, and you kicked them out of the country, else we would have been, there's more of us, and then you wouldn't have been as concerned, right? But it was the paranoia way back when that led us to the place where we don't understand these people, they're new here. Well, we were here, then you couldn't be here, and then you can be here. Mm. It's like, let's just let people be here and just be good people.
But if I've heard you on that, you're hearing sentiment that investors are concerned about the uncertainty? Is that what you've said, if I've heard you properly?
So there's a balance, right? For instance, I wouldn't get international investors during our financial crisis. That's something different.
Sure.
Right. Now, people are concerned about whether this country welcomes them or not. And so you got these tensions, right? You'll have tensions in China or other places where you're not sure about the stability of the markets or protect property rights. Mm-hmm. So all over the place. And so they want to come to the U.S., but when you hear people saying, hey, you know, we don't want people from your country or other things, right? Because when people plant a lot of money and jobs are here, right, and you're worried about your immigration, can I come here for my 3 months? Can I come here for my 6 months to track my investments? And you're not sure. It's like, why would I plant my money if I'm not sure I can go there and track my money?
Wow. That's new, folks. That's very new in the United States. Yes.
The every problem is facing by the government in South Asia countries, the misuse of narcotics and drugs. So one question that I would like to know from Mr. Chiang, whether the government of California, they have a special budget expenditures to escape the young generation from the drugs abuse. Because nowadays in my country, the attack of the drugs is not only in the city, but also now entry to suburban and some to the village. So one that I'm more clear, I think California also facing, because we are surprised. We heard here the government have planned to make legal of marijuana. Yeah. Thank you.
How to deal with drug rehabilitation for young children, especially given that some drugs are now legal here, I think is there a budget item to help with drug treatment?
Yeah, and there will be a lot more with the passage of the cannabis initiative.
Yes.
Right, I mean, there's a whole bunch of issues before and since the voters passed it, but yes, there will be a set pot of money. How it's used, we need to make sure that it's used effectively in the process. But actually, right, you're saying you're from Indonesia, that's to the earlier question, mm-hmm. right? So, you know, a lot of that stereotype, you know, Muslims come from the Middle East, but you got tons of Muslims from Asia, right?
Yeah.
And so when Muslims and others, right, when they're talking about investing mm-hmm. in the United States and California, that's part of the concern, mm-hmm. right? It's like, hey, if we can't come into this country or we can't stay here, it's like, hey, you know, those stereotypes don't work.
Yeah, is this a safe place? I would love to continue our conversation. I know I've enjoyed it tremendously. The audience has as well. And I want to thank you for taking the time to come and talk and share your insights. Thank you so much.
Wanted to thank both Treasurer Chiang and Professor Ramtran for a very fascinating discussion and for all of your questions and for attending as well. I'd also like to thank one more time our sponsors. We cannot put on a program like this without the sponsors, so thank you very much. And I wish we had more time because I wanted to talk about the Affordable Care Act, and I'm a little concerned about pensions in California and other things. But we got to go teach now. We're pleased that you took time out of your busy day to join us, and please join us for an event in the future. We're very excited about this being our inaugural event, so I think we'll do some more breakfasts in the future. So thank you again for coming. Thank you very much.